No, it's not your bad at all. We're going now. We're trying a different view to get a better camera of the slides, which we're not traditionally having a good job. They don't show up very well on camera. Those of you that have looked, you kind of got to use your imagination. So we're going to try to get it this way and see if we can get a little bit better view on the slides. So what we're introducing here is the idea of what of the tasks can we do in parallel. That's the concept or the idea behind fast tracking that we want to do. So we're gonna go to the idea of cost planning. We're gonna introduce a few slides about that. We're gonna watch a video about that, and then we're gonna work on the handout assignment on what impact do we have with cost and cost planning. I gotta change this for a second. If you excuse me and see if we can't get a. We'll make do with that. So why do we want to do cost planning? Obviously, cost is important to some people. It gives us the ability to earn our value by helping manage costs. It prevents the project from running into a cost overrun. If we don't have a strict budget, costs tend to do what? They balloon, they run away. I mean, you notice that when you go to Walmart. If you don't have a budget when you walk in the door, when you roll out, it costs you more than you thought it was going to cost you. And Costco has mastered that. It automatically costs you $300 to go in, and if you're careful. If you're not careful, it costs more than that. And it's all 20 bucks at a time. You know, it's not, you didn't buy anything super expensive. You know, you bought this stuff, well, this is worth $15, that's not much, put it in the cart. Next thing you know, it's $300 to leave. And that is, if we're not, now you can go. I've gone to Costco and bought 24 roses once, and that's all I bought. I can't believe it really happened. You can get out of there for less than $300, but you've got to really be focused in order to do that. And that's project management, isn't it? Really be focused. Being really focused on what it is, and that's, the cost management is part of that focus that we have a benefit of. We have a before and after thing to look at. So the company can get better because of me, because of the project manager. The company can get better at managing jobs because they can look at what we thought it was going to cost us, and then we look at what it really did cost us, and we find out we didn't manage the project as well as we thought we did. And an example of that in real life is any of you that have crews that are out on installs. We round installs often to a full day, the nearest full day. And an install is 2 days, when in reality it's really only a day and a half. We lose the half day, and that half day is not charged anything. But the company still has to pay for all of us, right? And so you're still clocked in, you're still doing the job, but you're not doing that job, but there's no real job to assign your labor cost to. So the total cost of the job actually is artificially high because you charge labor to the job that didn't really need to be charged to the job. If we could have squeezed that labor out and put it on another project, we would be more profitable as a company. So that's something we want to have understanding of. We are managing a schedule, we are managing the cost, and we are managing the quality, or the performance, if we want to call it that way. There are several ways to do cost planning or estimating, and I'm going to mention them here, and then on the next set of slides that we're going to look at, I am going to ask you to help me define them. So there's bottom-up estimating, there is parametric estimating, and there is top-down estimating, and something called a reverse analysis. And where each of these are different methods of coming up with a cost plan. Now, cost plan is fancy words for guess, a guess. A lot of business terms that the MBAs from Harvard talk about, you need a pro forma to open your business. You do need a pro forma to open your business. You need financial projections. You do need those. But what a pro forma is a guess. And what financial projections are is a guess. And what cost planning in a project is a guess. We don't know what it's really going to wind up costing us. But we want to manage it as closely as we can. We want to try to have some control over the guesses. But nonetheless, at the end of the day, it's still a guess. And that is a little bit of a problem. The inputs that we have to do, the tools that we do use to do our cost planning, we've got factors from the company itself. We've got some organizational assets that may apply towards this project. We may have resources within the company. We will develop a project scope statement, which I'm going to reflect on in a couple minutes. We've got the work breakdown structure that we've developed. Remember, we said that that's one of the early things you do in your project, no matter what. Come up with a work breakdown structure. You come up with the terminology that you've got to use in the work breakdown structure, a lexicon, a dictionary, so that everybody's on the same page of when you say, we're going to validate the microscopes. What does that mean? When I'm thinking validate, I turn it on and hit the on switch, and if the little red light turns to green, it's validated. But that may not be what the scientists are thinking about validating the microscope. So we define our terminology in the work breakdown structure dictionary. We develop a plan, we schedule the plan with precedence and what has to follow what. We figure out how we're going to manage it and fill the labor, and we develop a listing of what risks we have to manage in this project. Risk management's our next topic. Right now I'm gonna stop right there. Now look at a video on cost planning. I'm going to look at a couple maybe, and then we will do one. Let's see here. We'll look at a couple of rather short ones. Basics of project cost management and the ABCs of it.
Today we're talking about the basics of project cost management. Well, there's so much to say about cost on projects, but today I want to focus on three areas. I want to talk about why it's so important, I want to talk about what it really is, and then I want to provide some tips that I found helpful for me in managing the cost of my projects. Well, first of all, let's talk about why it's so important. Well, it's important because by using cost management on your project, it helps you to set the baseline for your project cost. And then therefore, that governs the actions you take to keep the budget on track. So ultimately, what we're doing is we're trying to prevent going over budget. But if we don't use it, here's some things that could happen. The company might lose money because some of the costs could exceed the project, and also could cause your customers to be invoiced incorrectly. So let's look at what cost management really is. Well, cost management is a process for managing your cost of your project, and it includes estimating your cost. So all the cost on your project, so that you get a detailed list of all the estimates at a task level. Then you take that and you develop your project budget. So the deliverable is you have your project budget that you baseline all your cost again at the task level. And you take that and it's used to control the spending for your project. So you ultimately have a set of action steps you take to keep on track. So let's look at a project budget template. So when we look at this, we look at the project and we have all the tasks or even maybe some subtasks. What we look at the labor, material cost, and all of the costs. So the labor is measured in how many hours for that task, and how much we're paying per hour. The task may have some kind of material cost where we measure that in units and there is a dollar cost per unit. Then we have other costs like maybe your travel cost, maybe any kind of equipment or space, and any other fixed or miscellaneous cost. Then at the task level, you have your budgeted amount, and as you track along the way, you ultimately get to what it actually costs for that task. So in the end, every task, and even at the full project level, you look at where you come out. Like, are you under budget, or are you over budget at the task level and at the project level? And again, we're looking to go under budget. So there are a few things I want to point out on the template. So some costs are easier to collect. Some of those look like your labor cost or even your consulting fees, maybe your raw materials or even software license, and even your travel cost. And then some of the costs may change, or they may be shared among other projects, or they may even carry over to other projects. And some of those look like your telephone charges, maybe even your office space or office equipment, maybe your general administration, and your company insurance. So let's look at some tips on how you can improve managing your cost. Well, first of all, you want to plan for inflation. If you happen to have a project that is short in duration, it may not be as impacted by inflation, but if an unexpected event occurs, it could impact the inflation on your project. And again, if you have a longer project in duration that spans a couple of years, inflation may impact it. It may even make your cost increase, or it may cause them to decrease. You also want to account for natural disasters. And we've all probably been impacted, or we know people who have been impacted by these natural disasters that can cause your cost, or even may impact some of the resources on your project. So you also want to account for any other potential events. For instance, some industries are impacted maybe by union labor or any kind of strikes or things that go on. So you also want to include unexpected costs, and some of those may look like some legal fees maybe you didn't anticipate, or any kind of penalties maybe in certain industries. They sometimes get penalties, and even labor costs. For instance, if for any reason you need a subject matter expert, those costs may be more than you anticipated. You also want to track these in real time so you can respond promptly. Because what we know is if any deviations happen, they tend to compound and impact your project negatively. So you also want to size and scale accordingly. So some people think maybe they're small projects, they don't really have to do cost management, but any kind of deviations can really impact their budget negatively. And then large projects, what you want to do is you want to do your cost management, and typically at a greater level of detail. But both of these, small versus large, is typically the same process. But if you need a tool that can help you manage your cost on your project, then sign up for our software now at projectmanager.com.
There are a number of software programs. We're going to get into a couple of them later that will help us in project management. We'll watch another short video clip before we look at our assignment.
Money can be stressful, let alone when you're trying to track money on a project. Oh, well, I'm going to share with you some of my techniques on project cost management to help you on this. Now, if you really want to master your project management skills, stay tuned to the end of this video, because I'm going to share with you how you can get your hands on a guide on how to ensure your projects don't fail. Hi, welcome. My name is Adriana Girdler, and you've landed on the best practical project management channel out there in the universe, YouTube land. Well, my personal opinion, and I hope you agree. And on that note, I hope you subscribe, because it really tells YouTube we're doing a good job and you're loving the content. Now, on that note, do you want to learn more about project cost management? Well, let's get to it. What is project cost management? Well, project cost management is the process you use in order to manage and control and monitor your costs. This includes estimating, budgeting, controlling of the costs that were given to you for you to execute the project, and project cost management is ensuring that you stay within those boundaries. Why does cost management matter? I hope that doesn't sound like a really silly question, but you'll be surprised. Some people don't actually even understand what their budget is for their project. And it does matter, because in project management, it's all about your scope, time, and budget. Now, if you're not managing your budget or you're not understanding what your costs are, it can really have a huge impact on your timelines, because if you need to do more things, you may have to extend your timeline. It's a big impact when it comes to risk, because you may need to have, you may have some risks that pop up and you need some contingency planning, but that contingency planning may be linked to monies, so you can't do it because you don't have a budget or you don't understand your budget. Or you may have to rearrange things and maybe do things slightly differently, but are still within scope. But because of budget, it's dictating you to do that. So understanding your budget, whether you manage it or not, because on some projects, the finance person may be managing that, but they have to be working with you so you can understand what exactly do you have left, how much is given, so you can understand it in the greater picture of managing your project and the other elements that pop up, right? So that becomes important that you understand that, as well as it's important for resourcing too. Okay, let's get the first most obvious thing that you do with cost management out of the way. That is track your spending. Okay, that's a given. You have a budget, it doesn't magically get tracked on its own. Someone has to track it, and that's what you need to do. It just allows you to understand, here's my baseline, how much have I spent to date, and where are we in the project timeline, and what do we have that's being called out against it, and are we okay, or do I need to actually go and ask for more monies? So that tracking your spending becomes a very critical activity that you have to do for project cost management. Maintain good time management. What? Etrina, we're talking about project cost management. I'm like, yeah, I know. That's why I'm telling you to maintain really good time management. What did I say earlier on about scope, time, and budget? These are all linked. So you really need to, as part of your cost management, is to have really good time management. Time and money go together. If you extend your project time, I promise you, you need more money in order to help you do that. So it becomes really important that you keep not only track of your spending, but you keep track of your timing, because there is a direct correlation and relationship between the two. So really good time management also equates to really good budget management. Plan for contingencies. Okay, with cost management within a project, as I said in the earlier tip, things are going to pop up. You need to ensure that you have some contingency planning funds in your project budget. And you need to understand that from a risk perspective of your project, because if you're doing really good project management, you're doing some initial risk assessment. And we have mitigation and contingency plans for risk assessments. In fact, what we want to do is, if risk does come to fruition, what do we have to do to minimize that impact? And I wish to say things were free, and they're not. There's usually some sort of cost associated with it. So you need to ensure that with your good contingency planning, that you're linking it to your budget. So you know what you need to ask for or rearrange within your current budget to cover that particular contingency. Have a change control strategy. This, to me, is critical on any project of any size, is how are you going to manage change? Because a lot of times, without you realizing, hallway conversation, the manager says, hey, can you just add this to your project? They don't understand that simple request could increase your budget, could increase your time. Oh my goodness, then what? So you need to have an understanding of how to manage change. And there's change control that you can implement, which is directly tied into your budget. Because you can nip things in the bud so they don't snowball into an additional activity that you didn't plan for. You now need resources against. You need either maybe some software, some activities that have to occur, and it's not within your budget. Then what do? Oh my goodness, that's the last thing. You want to manage your budget, right? You want to keep it to the original cost that you were given, ideally, unless something happens, like a big risk, and that's a different story. But that all being said, really having a good change control strategy, a way of working so you can monitor that when something does come into play, how are we going to deal with it so that you can be on top of that budget and keep your project running. Project resource review. Projects do not happen on their own. There's no AI artificial intelligence that can execute a project. You need people. So I leave this last because I've had to help with budgets and estimations all the time. We always look at resourcing. And I struggle with this. And maybe some of you struggle too. If you have, put in the comments below. Give me your stories. Because I struggle with this. I know why resourcing is looked at, because you can estimate the amount of time a person is going to be on a project. But my struggle is this. When it comes to external resources, like you're hiring another organization, a consultant, a firm, whatever, they have to do a standard of work. And in that standard of work, it's usually laid out in good detail what they're going to be delivering to. So that cost is pretty much locked in. And usually if it's going to exceed that cost, there's a negotiation that happens. And it's usually because there's an additional activity that's being requested from them. So I find managing resources externally to an organization is actually quite easy and simple to do because of that process of having that standard of work. What I struggle with is when I'm asked to estimate internal resources. Well, number one, companies don't make their internal organization individuals to do an SOW, a statement of work, on the project they're going to do. Nobody does that. If a company does, let me know. I've never come across it, and I've worked with a lot of companies and a lot of big organizations. So then you're doing this. What do I think it's going to be? And so you're usually at the beginning of the project when you're doing these type of estimations as well. So you haven't even come across issues in the project yet that may need someone's more time. So a lot of time I kind of guess. I think it's about 25%, but here's the magic word that I now do when I'm asked to estimate on resources. It is an average across the whole project. There may be, and this is my little disclaimer I tell them, there may be times I need that person 50% for this short period of time, and maybe I only need them 5% for the rest of the time or in certain bits and pieces, but the average may be 25. So I struggle because sometimes people will go, you said it was 25%. I'm like, well, I didn't account for this other stuff that popped up. That's project, 101. Risks happen, things change, they evolve. But that is something that when I do have to do resource loading and looking at that from an estimation standpoint, go higher than what you think you're going to go, because I promise you it's going to have happened. You're probably going to have to use that person a little bit more than you anticipated. So always going up and padding it a bit is just going to help you in the long run. Now that you know how to manage project costs and some of the techniques, oh my goodness, I'm going to get to it. I told you to stay to the end. What do I have for you? Free, my gift to you. How to identify the top 10 project mistakes project managers make, because this will definitely derail your project and potentially add more costs. So something you want to avoid for sure, for sure. Where can you get this? Well, it's under the...
I will pass that out to you at a later time. Right now, we're going to do more on project cost management before we're done today. But I want to use that sort of as an introduction to project cost management. And then we are going to go back to our exercise where we are looking at the dependency diagramming first. And then we are going to include an exercise that has cost numbers with it to be able to crash the project. We read the three tasks in class at the end of the day on Thursday. Today we are going to do them. Before we do that, I wanted to visit two things, a blank one and a non-blank one, on a project charter that is part of what I want you to include with your Christmas party project plan, the project charter. And so there are lots of templates of what a project charter entails. This is a blank one it's just one that I've used. It's not one that's remarkably better or worse than others that are out there. But some of the things that typically are covered in a project charter, it's often a one-page document or a two-page document. It's not a contract written up by a lawyer. If you notice on here, it's got key pieces of information. In this particular case, it's a company that's doing EV chargers at shopping malls for the shopping carts that people can ride around on, scooters. So the project will have a name. We're going to put a contact of the project manager in their email. The project sponsor will be named. The phone number of the project manager will be there, the organizational unit, if that's appropriate, if it's a large company. If there are continuous improvement people or Lean Six Sigma green belts or black belts that you have, that their task is to help projects. Many companies are organized that way these days. Our smaller ones here in Southern Utah aren't as often, but you most likely will be involved with a project, with a program, with a company somewhere along the line that has those types of resources. We put when we expect the project to start, when we expect it to be done, and what we expect it to cost. And if it's a cost savings type of a task, a project, put the cost savings down. If it's a Christmas party, it's not a cost savings deal. So you wouldn't go there because that's not appropriate. A lot of projects are designed, we're gonna buy a new CNC, and that's a project. And we expect at the end that by having that resource, we'll be able to save money in overall costs. And so that expected savings in that case would go there. The table of contents are simply what the scope is, what the schedule is looking like, what resources are going to be demanded or required, what the benefits and who the customers are that get them, what risk we've associated with it, constraints, assumptions, and then who we are. And so those things can often appear on one page. They may look something like this. The overview of the project will list the issue or the symptoms that are occurring, our purpose, what we want it to look like when we magically accomplish it, the business case, the money, how we're going to measure the metrics, the goals, what's the scoreboard look like, expected deliverables, what it is we want to do with them. The stuff that's within the scope that we're envisioning and the stuff that's outside of that scope, if you know what they are, we want to put those boundaries down right away and say, this is in bounds and this is out of bounds for this project. We're not evaluating market pricing in our distribution network. We're looking at production. Whatever the boundaries are that you know that somebody's going to throw at your project at some point, we say that's outside the scope of this project. We put that in the project charter so that later when they try to do it, you go, you signed this. You know, we already said we weren't going to be doing that. Now, we can't do it, but it's not in this project. It's not with this budget. We need to do that with a different project, with a different budget. What the schedule is going to be, and we'll put start and finish dates or hours there. We're going to get the team together. We are going to make it the plan together, including this charter. We're going to put, in the case of a continuous improvement project, we're going to define the problem. We're going to define how we're going to measure it. We're going to analyze what the data collected is. We're going to improve or propose an improvement. We're going to control it or standardize it, and then we're going to close it out and report on it. So that may be a completely different schedule than you have on your project, but this is just where you put your schedule in and the start and stop. And this is going to become a work breakdown structure at some point in time. What resources you need, who's on the team, who's going to support, special needs, you need permission, you need passwords, you need help, whatever it is, we need to borrow the company truck. Whatever resource it is, we put them there. What we expect the costs to be and the total amount of those costs, if it's a labor, we want to put the labor rates down so they understand what basis we're figuring our costs on. Different types of skill levels have different labor rates. And if that's a sensitive issue in your company, use round numbers and don't reveal what your wage is and what somebody else's wage is. That's not the purpose of this document. The purpose of the document is to capture the effort. We're gonna summarize what benefits there are to the process owner, to the stakeholders, to the final customer. We're going to talk about those. We're going to talk about the cost savings, enhanced revenue, the higher productivity for the staff, improved compliance we're going to get, better decision making, less maintenance required, other costs avoided. That's just an example of things that could be on there. you wouldn't have all of those most likely, but those are the kind of things, and you could put a dollar amount next to it if that was appropriate and wanted to do it. Your risks, your constraints, your assumptions, you put down there, and then you sign off on it. And usually I like to get the signatures of everybody on that page, including the bosses. So that's an example of a project charter. If we looked at the same project charter filled out, this is what it might look like. So Jane Matthews is a project manager. Jill's a sponsor. They're putting in positive charge EMV stations around. We'll read about that. The organizational unit is field engineering operations and project management. This is how you get a hold of them. This is this assistance that they are looking for to be able to draw from. Same table of contents, but this time it's all written out, the problem or issue. Our goal for this project is to install 1,125 EV charging stations at 116 locations across the U.S., Mexico, and Canada to accommodate malls and service stations EV charging needs. All right, that's more like a Tesla installation in this project, right, for the people that are driving electric vehicles. Purpose of project: implementation of the 1,100 charging stations will reduce fossil fuel emissions and have a positive impact on the environment, help fulfill positive charge, that's the name of this company, mission of being the world's largest EV charging provider and reduce the environmental impact of fossil fuel cars through our services. The business case, they put it down. It's gonna result in a 24% profit for positive charge, that's the company. The goal is to install those. The primary key performance indicators are revenue growth, client retention rate, and customer satisfaction. They named those three things, saying that's what they're going to track to determine the success of the project. Expected deliverables, 116 locations with new charging systems. The scope says we're going to come put it in. We're going to use third-party client site personnel to do the installation locally. Outside the scope, we are not responsible for preparing the locations. That means getting permits for digging, city or the region of electricity, the availability of where it's at. They need to give drawings, and we're going to give drawings, and the project managers will go through a checklist to make sure locations are prepared for installation. Wilding does the same thing. You send a prep list to your customer, and they have to have certain things in place, like a space. You know, you don't think so, Jake? Well, I'm thinking you ought to. You run into a little trouble here and there because you haven't. So that's kind of the extent of the scope stuff. Then the milestones of what they're going to do. They've got this spread over like 5 months of what they're going to do. Your project might not last that long. The costs are listed here. They are looking at an overall cost of $441,000 to do this at 116 sites. They've got the project team and support there. What kind of benefits are going to get? They're estimating a $250,000 benefit. That's part of the business case. The risks, the constraints, the assumptions, they've put those in there. I will post this, and they've signed off on it. I will post this on Canvas so you can look at it, but you can Google Project Charter, and there's dozens of templates that you could use. Any template that you make up your own, any template you choose to use is fine. For the Christmas party project, it's just that you need to have a template, or you need to have a charter of some sort. That makes sense? Questions from that? All right, let's go to let's start on the assignment sheets, the network diagramming. This is the handout that you took on Thursday. Some of you don't have that. I have 8 extras that were in my briefcase that are here. I will put them back by the sign-in sheet and where there's a stack of paper. Everybody's going to need some paper. Each team, I'm going to split you up into pairs of 2 or 3. Let's do as follows. Josie and Brad, work together if you would. You two work together. You two work together. You two work together. You two work together. You three work together. Okay? And so you need your and so what you're going to do, this is the assignment for the first exercise.
I'm good. Yeah.
And you're going to draw it up together. Maybe each of you should draw the same thing just to have the experience of drawing it. And on the first exercise, this is the table, the activity table that you're going to look at. Duration is in weeks. We don't have any costs. There are 3 things that we want you to answer for that question. Construct the project network for this project. Find the earliest time, the latest time, and the slack for each of the activities. Use this information to determine which of the paths is a critical path. If all the other activities take the estimated amount of time, what is the maximum duration of activity D without delaying the completion of the project? So I want you to answer those 3 questions, and you're using this activity table.
Are we using a 0 or are we using a 1?
Yeah.
You guys decide what you want to do. I like using the 0, but you guys use whatever you want. You've learned that you can, that's a good question, you've learned you can do both.
I gotta write it out to figure it out in my head. So the critical path, what the critical path means is what's the path that pretty much takes the longest, right? Mm-hmm. I'm gonna get my calculator out. I'm not really good. So there's 1, 2, 3, 4 different paths. Right? So we got B, C, D, F, G. So bing, bing, bang, bang, bang. And we got A, D, A, E, F, G. We also got A, D, F, G. And we also got A, D, G. this right here. It tells us how long each path is. 5 weeks, 2 weeks, 2 weeks, 4 weeks, 6 weeks, 3 weeks, 5 weeks. Okay. If my math is correct and what I'm doing is correct, the critical path is AEFG. So we got these three different, we got to figure out A, B, and C. Right? So construct the project network for this project. That's the project network. Okay. Find the earliest time, latest time in the Slack for each of the activities. Use this information to determine which are the paths or critical paths. So kind of already figure out what is the critical path. A, E, F, G. What's the earliest time? A, D, G. The earliest time in 14 weeks. What is the slack time for each week? So that what the slack time is. What the slack time means is so the critical path is what's the longest path in 14 weeks. And the slack time is the time, the 19th. So we have B, C, D, F, G, or that takes 16 weeks. The slack time is 19 out of 16. So for that one, the slack time is 3 weeks. Slack time for ADFG is 2 weeks.
Okay. So slack time for ADFG is 2 weeks.
Yeah.
Because that's what they start on G, right?
And the late slack time for ADG is 5 weeks.
The late finish on
ADG?
Yeah. But does that make sense what the slack time means?
I mean,
so like the critical path. So what the critical path means is that's the time that like takes the longest. It has to take 19 weeks.
Right.
These other weeks don't take 19 weeks, but to finish this main project, this main project network,
mm-hmm.
takes 19 weeks, but then there's also other project networks that have to occur. And they just take things okay, next one. If all the activities take the same amount of time, what is the maximum duration of activity without delaying the completion of the project?
Trying to do all three of these right now? We're doing one at a time.
We're doing one at a time. If you, how many have finished one?
We finished A and B. We're on C.
Okay. A few more minutes. If you want to go ahead and start working on two, you can. But when everybody's done with one, I want to pause and talk about that. So kind of let me know when each of you are done, if you would. Looks like we got about half done and half still working.
Thank you.
So this is just for the pass right here, right? So when we bring the critical path down, is the first start there with the progression.
Yeah.
Right.
So how you always want to start it, right, is you have a start, okay, then it tells us on here,
okay,
on the second page, and since these A and B don't have any immediate predecessors, that means it comes from the start, right? Right? But if they still have duration weeks, they still have time to do those, because the description does a select location, detain keynote, speaker. So, since they start from the start, they take 1 week each to do from the start. Then you got C. If you see in here, then you can kind of look on my, obviously, you can look on my chart that I have. It's a little bigger. You can see there's more letters, so I don't know. I thought it was going to be bigger. But if you look on the chart that I have, C is the predecessor of B. Right? So you have to draw a line from B to C. Then you have D. Then you have D. And the predecessor of D is A and B. So where you have A and B, you have D, but the predecessor of D is A and B, so you have to draw a line from A and B to D. Same thing, but with E, the immediate predecessor of E is A and C. So you have to draw a line from A and C. There's going to be awkward lines.
Yeah.
If you look at mine, they're all awkward lines. Like there's no, the chart, I mean this is just a line chart. There's a different type thing that we call a Gantt chart that is a little bit more descriptive of weeks. But at any rate, so then we go to F, right? The predecessor of F is only A. Then G, again, the only predecessor of G is A. Then we have H. Predecessor of H is C and G. Then we have I.
Yeah, that's what
the predecessor of I is H. Then we have J, the predecessor of J is I. Then we have K, that's going to be the weird one. The predecessor of K is C and F. If you look on mine, I don't know how you drawn it out a little bit different than mine, obviously. I had to draw a line and you kind of remember us seeing your video of it, where if it goes over the line, then you just do a little hop over it. You just pretend to show that it hopped over it. I didn't go through weeks. It's kind of my bad. If you look on my thing, each line has a week. Right? I'll go back through it again. So with C, maybe I would try and draw it out again, make it a little bit bigger. So then each line has enough space to show what. What is what? So, 1 week each from the start. Then you have C, which is the predecessor of B, and then when you draw the line from B to C, it's that line has got 3 weeks. Try to do the same thing with D. Remember, D is the predecessor of A and B. And if you look at mine, it's the predecessor of A and B. Right, so there's going to be two lines going to D. But both, I say not but, but both of those lines are 2 weeks.
So,
E, remember, is the predecessor of A and C.
Still all of our other lines not critical.
Okay, you've gotten them all written down?
Yeah.
Okay, now what you want to try and find is the paths. So here, I'll go off yours. No, that's fine. That's good. So, there's no really, especially in this one, there's no really like end. This one. Kind of end was G. This one did it on purpose with really no end in a sense. I mean, there isn't. If we would have done a different type of chart, there would be an end. But anyways. So, you gotta find all the different types of paths. I got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 different paths, a lot of different types of paths. So you got AD, BD, BCE, BCHIJ, AFK, AGHIJ. So kind of just go through each different path. See, like on mine, I have BD, BCHIJ, BCK, BCE, AGHIJ, AD, AFK, which I already named all of them right there. So kind of just start at A and then look at all the different lines that are coming from A.
Let's pause for a moment. I know that most of you are working on Project 2 or Project 3, but let's go back to Project 1 and make sure everybody got on the same page for what we're doing here. So what were your answers to on Project number 1? The question, construct the project network for this project. Find the earliest time, the latest time, and the slack for each of the activities, and then determine from that which is the critical path. So what did you get for a critical path, starting with A or B?
A.
Yeah, A?
A.
Yeah. So what was your critical path? A what?
A, E, F, G.
A, E, F, G. Does everybody pretty well agree with that?
Mm-hmm.
All right. So hopefully then you constructed your diagram something like this. Maybe you don't have it exactly the way I have it. That's quite all right. Maybe I'm wrong. But we started with drawing precedents. We did not, on my drawing, I didn't draw a start or finish. Remember, a lot of times we can put a node, a circle, or an oval to the left of A and B and call that start. And then at the end of G, in this case, we'd write finish or done, or end, whatever word you want to use, to kind of define the beginning and the end. On this simple diagram, we don't need to do that. The next diagram, it's a little cleaner if we do do that. But on this one, we start out with the boxes A, B, C, D, E, F, G, based on the precedents that were given from the table. My way was to start with putting above the A the number 5, above B the number 2. That's on the duration, right? We label the duration in the box. And then from that duration in the box, you've got them all in there. And we can see A, E, F, G was the critical path, the duration being 5, 6, 3, and 5 for that path, giving us a duration of 19 weeks. The closest second would be A, D, F, G at 17, then 16, 14, and 13. So the most amount of slack we have is in the shortest path, the 13-week path. But we figure our forward paths, the numbers at the top, starting with 0. We started with 1 in that little difference. At the end, we end at 19 weeks, and we backpedal the 19 weeks backwards. And as we do that on our critical path, we see the slack of 0 at A, the slack of 0 at E, the slack of 0 at F, the slack of 0 at G. The question we had was, how much slack do we have on D? Right? Was that the question that was asked?
Yes.
Okay, so find that we did the early and late time, determine the critical path. If all of the activities take the estimated amount of time, what is the maximum duration of activity D without delay? The completion of the project. I think that's kind of an oddly worded question. My interpretation of that question was to say that we have 5 weeks of slack on D, and that can be spent in any way we want, except that if we stretch it out and we start 5 weeks at the fifth week as early as we can, and we finish as late as we can, that's going to have a domino effect on F, right? That's going to have a domino effect, potentially. So you can't spend slack in two squares at once. You only have it in one opportunity of spending slack. In this case, do you have a question?
No.
Okay, you're just resting.
Yeah.
Okay. That's quite all right. So did we all get the same answer as we worked through there pretty well? Okay, yes?
So why are there two answers?
Okay, when we come backwards through, we have D feeds to F and to G. At F, our latest start is 11 weeks. Our earliest start is 0 slack. It has to start at 11 weeks. So at G, it has to start at 14 weeks. So our D activity has to be finished by 14 weeks for G, but when we do our backwards pass, we see that an 11 is a lower sequential activity, so we scratch the 14 out and put 11 in the D box. Does that answer the question kind of okay?
Roughly
okay. So on the forward pass going through, if we have the same number, we use the bigger number. On the backwards pass, we use the lower number when we're feeding a number from two boxes. When we're going this way, we're feeding a number from two boxes. For example, E, and D, the latest finish, the earliest finish for E is at 11 weeks. The earliest finish for D is at 9 weeks.
Yeah.
So going forward there, I use the bigger of the two in the 11. And then when I come backwards, I'm feeding from the G and the F into the D, and I use the smaller of the two. If that makes sense. Because I'm looking for how many weeks must I start? You know, what's the... That's a critical path, but this is not critical path. There's no D in the critical path. My slop is in D. So how early can I start D? I could start D at week 5. I could start D week 6, week 7, week 8, week 9, or week 10, and still finish on time. If I finish, you know, you could run those numbers and put them in if you wanted to, but the slack is 5, if that makes sense to everybody. If not, let's do it again with the next one, and we'll try another one. So let's look at, are you not done with this two? Is everybody done with two?
Towards the end.
Towards the end. Let's take a break. As you need to. Finish up two, we'll talk about it, then we'll hit project three. Okay?
Your math is wrong, bosses.
What's that?
Your math is wrong.
It quite likely is. Show me where I need to change
it. So your slack on D at 5 days is 14 minus 9, right? So if you go 14 minus 4, which is your duration on your backwards pass, that gives you 10, right? But what you should have done was 11 minus 4, which would have been 7. So your slack there is 2 days, not 5 days. Because what you did here, so you've done your math here on 14, right? Backwards. So 14 minus 4 is 10. 5 minus 4. But you should have done your backwards pass with your 11 minus 4. 11 minus 4 is 7. Okay, gotcha. I didn't see that. Well, it is right there. It looks like part of your arrow. Okay. So your slack here would actually be 2 and not 5.
No, 11
to
7 is 4. Well, no, that 4 is the amount of time.
Right. I was just trying to make sure that that I understand it correctly.
You do understand correctly. And 5 doesn't make sense down here. A slack of 2 puts us down to this path.
Right.
As well. So these numbers are all correct.
got to be, don't you think? That's on both of you there. Richard Paper's beautiful.
Oh.
What do you have on the second project? How did you draw that?
Oh, man, that's a lot more.
That's a mess. What I've got is a mess.
Mine's a mess also.
Oh, so. Well, it's less of a mess. From here, it's good.
But
we've got crossing wires, though.
Yeah, bunch of crossing.
You've got less than I do. I have six.
You may have got. I missed like the first first one of the stuff and I've been lost ever since. Okay.
I mean, really, as long as it goes in the direction of the building, when you chart your critical path, you know, like that.
Yeah.
Not critical. You chart all the possible traits.
He's got some of the people better here. I'll tell you this. They're wrong.
Wrong.
Yeah. We're just going to have to come back to it. I'm glad I used pencil because on this one, you got to go back to the eraser.
Yeah. So the answer to your question was, you had a back there. Did you hear me say that? I have the right numbers down there. Go take an extra long break and go over to the CNC shop and show this to Rick and ask him if he has any
ferric
but if you don't mind showing him that, he'll appreciate what you did there. You go downstairs and straight out the door on that way and just keep going across to the door that's there and the CNC shop is on the left.
Okay.
And Brig is the big guy with the black shirt.
Yeah. gets a parent clearance.
He may have some. Yeah, he may have some. I mean, he may have some because we've got some stuff.
Have you?
Yeah. He may have some. If he doesn't, give it to us.
Okay.
Yeah. So it's worth that. It's worth
that. Say hi to him.
And he'll admire your handiwork anyway.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thanks.
I know I missed like 2 weeks of school. I don't know if it's on my email, but I missed every assignment for like all the notes.
No, but I'll try to put some more up.
Okay.
So that you can accept the videos on YouTube. Mm-hmm.
Oh, are they?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
What's the YouTube channel?
It's just Steve Carell.
Okay. I'm making a video. Thank you.
Okay. This is not. We're ready for these weapons.
I think it's all more.
continue to work on exercise number two. Kind of let me know when you're finished on that. We'll talk about it. But before we do that, I want to go back to the answer on exercise one. I've corrected my paper. I made a mistake on what I put up before. Let me show you the difference. That's what I had up, and I said 5 weeks slack time, and I didn't cross out my 14 on the way backwards, and so I made a math mistake that was pointed out by Andrew and team. And so if you can, this pointer, does it show? Yeah, sorry. So I changed it, it's 2 weeks, because I should have crossed out the 14 as I went backwards. I did have the 11 and the 7 there. I simply looked at the wrong difference and said it was 5 weeks slack when it's really 2 weeks. 9 to 11 is 2, or 5 to 7 is 2. So our slack is 2 weeks on D. The right answer is 2 weeks. And that fits down here also on our critical path. D if we did 5 weeks of slack out of D, that would bump into that. So the 2 weeks slack works. And that's the correct answer for that one. So continue on where you left off before we took a break with exercise two, and we'll work together on that after you are prepared, ready to do that. So,
right.
She had to leave early. She did.
Okay. Welcome aboard.
Great, great. Perfect time for you to come over because I'm on the crash with Mark on two.
Yeah, we're here ready to move to three.
You ready to move to three? How about this one? Three. Did you crash a little bit?
Well,
as long as
crash car real quick on two.
Otherwise, crash car is not good one at all. And we're just about to start on crash. You guys did the. Early start, early finish, like and I did in the beginning.
Which I should have a question.
Start with
what we do, it's telling us here. Let's look at. So what it's saying. Right here. So activities with a duration of 1 week cannot be crashed. So what is scheduled for 2 or 3 weeks can be crashed by 1 week.
There's a clock.
Activity K can also be crashed by 2 weeks. So given a unit crashing cost of $3,000 for C, D, and H, $5,000 for activity J and K, and $6,000 for activity E and F. So first you go through the ones that have a 1. You can't crash. J has 3. And you can crash. But H has a cost of $5,000 to crash. J has a cost of $6,000 to crash.
All of them.
You got it.
So we're going to want to put C, D, E around A.
this right here, you want to bring down your leg finish, right? That's how you are going to shorten your length of time. Now, as long as this stays your critical path, this is where you want to crash at along this line, right? But if you crash along this line, you also have to look at the effect that it has on every other line that is associated with that, right? So we crash here because it had minimal effect on everything else for our first meeting, right? For 3 days. And we had to do an additional backward. We had to do an additional forward pass from here and then an additional backward pass all the way down the line. And same for every game. He brought one. He came prepared. But I think that your number is pretty big. No, you only want to start with one. One note, and that's where you start. Along the curve of that, yeah. And you want the easiest way is to pick a note that is going to have at least not an impact. So if I can only change one node and have that effect, everything goes down that line, and I only have to worry about one line, that's the one that I'm going to pick. Because I don't want to pick one my math, make sure I'm not. So that on I, you ended up with 23, right? Because you've got
25 on I.
And you're, how do you get your ending duration of 5? How do you get 25?
Yeah, your ending duration of 5.
Oh, you're correct.
Right.
You're correct. But that's what it is. My mistake.
And then
five, yeah. So that would,
J,
this would be 25 plus 3 is 28.
There you go. There it is.
Thank you. So you're only changing by 1 week, right? And it gives you, you're only changing one note, right? You're not changing every note along that path. That's what it sounds like you're getting mixed up at, right?
Well, that's what I think. This would be taking out the 1 week.
Yeah, so you're adding all of these up to change your weeks, right? So you're technically what you're doing, you've been changing this by 1 week, this by 1 week, this by 1 week, can't because it's that 1 week, but you're also changing this by 1 week. But you are adding all of that up. Right? You don't need to do that. Right? So leave this as what it is. Don't touch this. Don't touch this. Okay? The only note you need to change is this on your J, on your backward pass, on your backward pass. So the J is your M, right? So everything that is going out of your J, so your F, because I and J both go to F, J is 25, I is 24, right? If the lowest one is, when you're going to pass backwards, that's going to be 23, right? And because we have said that A, C, F, I, J, and A, B, H, I, J is also a critical path, there should be zero slots, right? So this is going to be 18, that's going to be 18.
I guess you can just fill it in without getting
that. You could, yeah.
You need to describe this.
Correct. So we've also got, this is going to be 23, 16, 16 and 10, 10, which adds up, right? Along that path, there's zero slots on both of that. So data cost us 24 to do that, right? So we're only, and we're only tracking one thing instead of two.
Yeah.
But let's check C and E. What's the cost to crash the C? 9,000. So we probably don't want to do that around with that. Or E, which is 11,000. We're a lot more. It seems like the right answer is just crash the E. Because that'll have an impact overall.
Yeah, the path is to change.
Well, it will be we'll be crashing both critical paths at the same time.
Yes.
With only changing one item.
Plus this other line.
Plus this other line, right? So we would have to do the map on this, a forward path on this, to make sure that this doesn't become a critical path.
On
A, D, G, J. Right?
It should be crashing with the J, 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 by the same
because it's at 23. Right.
I mean, it has to be crashed.
So, B and H are left, or B-H-I-J.
B-H-I-J, but then they would all become critical path, right? Because you can't crash anything, right?
No, B-H-I-J is
B-H-I-J is 16 weeks.
So,
but H is part of the critical path.
Right, so if we crash, H, then this 16 will go even lower.
Yes.
Oh, okay.
Right?
Yep.
So we wouldn't even have to worry about this. That one. Yeah. Because we're trying to go to 25, we wouldn't have to worry about A, B, G, J, and we wouldn't have to worry about P, H, I, J.
So our duration on A is going to
be right. So that will be taking into account this, right? And you have to crash. Yeah, that's right. This will actually come down to 23 is going to crash that. Mm-hmm. And that would be the best thing to do. Crash A through dumps. Or, let's say, 8K a pop, 816.4. So that's what we're doing, right? Because when you crash something, you are changing the duration. And that's how we get the shorter time periods. Right? Because all of these are time periods. Right, because you have a dollar amount associated with each one. numbers don't change as the track report, right? Oh, so that money to change. We're saying, so we're only going to change the total age as one of the track reports. All of these durations, they point to the place before we track it. Then you can use a forward path, a backward path along the line. Right. So it's important that you do these, right? You've got it as far as your durations go. Along the path. Right. So if you look at your durations, A is 10, B is 4, C is 8, D is 6, E is 6.
Understanding that is going to make you feel pretty much. I'm going to change age.
So you work mission. So there's three activities that we're talking about. D, G, and B. The only ones
below the select and below
flat. Because everything else in Spanish away goes.
Is there more? Yes. Did I miss?
No, zero side.
You're just trying to go farther.
Or to see.
All right.
So we did.
You guys are going above and beyond.
Oh, you're doing C.
We finished B. Yeah.
Could we finish it? Could we finish it?
B.
No, I'm
sorry. Just with the math. Gotcha. Just with the
math. I think I gave
So you're almost done with exercise three, I'm hearing over here.
I didn't run the last one. It looks like the last one's going to take.
Almost. Well, let me take it home with you. And we'll start class on Thursday finishing this exercise up. By the way, you can take it to 20 weeks, not 19.
On the last one, yeah.
So you can look at your cost curve if you want to do extra. Take it up to
as far as you can get it.
As far as you can get it, which is 8 weeks. I can't.
You can't crash it farther than 8 weeks. Is that what you're saying?
I can't crash it farther than 9 weeks. Eight weeks is the maximum I can go.
Gotcha.
Unless you've got a better angle than I do.
Supposing that we're not trying to save money.
How far can we go? How far is it possible to crash
Based
on the constraints we've given?
Okay.
And that's just for whatever it's worth.
Right.
Okay, thanks guys for playing. We will see you on Thursday.